You know, on last week, we started a series of teaching, one dealing with your heart and asking the question, how troubled is your heart? Well, I pray that through the teaching that you may realize that in Jesus' word, and it's one of his, and I say his commandment, when he said, whenever he spoke, he said, let not your heart be troubled. And the challenges as we went through the scriptures on last week, and I would just ask that you maybe, if you didn't get the lesson or you weren't the participant live last week, just go back into YouTube and just review that. But it's so important because in our fatherhood of many mansions, and those are rooms were filled with the various victorious things we need in our lives, be it prosperity, be it love, be it peace of mind, be it just confusion being straightened out. See, God has those rooms in his mansion, and he brings you there so you can spend time in those rooms, because where he sits is right on the right hand of the Father. And his Father has been many mansions, and these rooms are equipped to handle, but he would direct you to that room that you need for the victory. Right now, I realize that, I understand that there are challenging times throughout, and people go through things. People may not want to admit it, but they have things going on in their lives. But God said, Jesus said through his word, I come to give you life, and I come to give you more abundantly. When he departed, he said, my peace, that's P-E-A-C-E, I leave with you. So there's no excuse for us not being in peace in the midst of confusion, in the midst of turmoil, in the midst of despair, because we trust in his word. We know that God is not a man that he should lie. God always and constantly watches over his word to perform it. He's that omnipotent God, that omnipresence God, that omniscient God. He's there all the time, wherever we need to be, whatever we need it. He's right there. And that's the challenge of us understanding. But Jesus said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. That's 24/7. But it's up to us to recognize his presence and acknowledge it through our understanding of obedience. Not delayed obedience, obedience right now. He's a right now God. When you pray, you don't want no delayed blessings. You want a right now blessing. Amen? Well, he wants a right time, right now person to be following, to adhere to him, to listen to him, to do those things that are pleasing in his sight. You know, I'm an interesting topic today here, and let me give that topic right off. Has your heart become hardened to God's voice, in parentheses, his word? Has your heart become hardened to God's voice, which is his word? Now, I want you to think about this for a minute. Well, no. Yes, no. Don't be so quick to answer. Because there have been times in each and every one of us that we knew what God's answer was before we asked. But we were trying to, in our own little way, in our own little spiritual content, was trying to get God to change and to adhere to what we want him to say or to do versus what his word says he will do. And because we knew that God was not going to hear what we want, we push away. Sometimes you ever hear people when they're angry about something and in despair, and you say, well, let's go to, I got time to go to the room. I don't want to hear that. Why? Because he may not be gone. You know, God's not going to go along with your mess. Let's just call it like it is. You know, I can't think of a better word, your mess. Because you're in a state of flux by which you're trying to resolve through your flesh, rather through the spiritual power of God's word that's in your life through the guidance of the Holy Spirit. You know, as we go into this teaching here, turn up to the third chapter of the book of Hebrews. Third chapter of Hebrews. One of the things that we have to look at, because unless God builds your house, your labor is in vain. What else are you talking about? Talking about this spiritual house that's inside of you right now. You know, we try to build it based on what we think we should do or how we should do it, rather than following the guidance of God of how it should be done. Each person is different. You know, everyone carries a different DNA, but we only have one spiritual path to follow to correct all those DNA. It's like our walking penicillin or antibiotic for the things that are inside of each and every one of us, which could be different, but in a way, it's the same. Our challenge is to make sure we hear from God and know His voice. The Bible said, my sheep know my voice, and a stranger they won't follow. But yet and still, we find ourselves going astray. Let's just look at this through the scripture. I'm just going to start the first verse, and I'm going to drop down to where I want to be in the seventh. But Hebrews 3rd chapter, it says, wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling. Are you a partaker of the heavenly calling? Okay. Consider the apostles and high priests of our profession. Christ Jesus. He's the one who we're supposed to be following. He's the one that we're really supposed to be representing here on the earth. He said that who was faithful to him that appointed him, as also Moses was faithful in all his house. Now, underline this part, was faithful to him who appointed him. You know, we all have certain appointments. This is why we use the virgin as a different paradigm of throwing, is that many are called, but few are chosen. Some are called, but they're not faithful in the calling, so he can't choose them to go further. Are you in that category? Well, that's a good question to ask. It says, verse 3, for this man was counted worthy of more glory than Moses. Who are we talking about? Christ. Inasmuch he who have built the house have more honor than the house. For every house is built by some man. But he that built all things is God. Please understand that. Please understand that. I'm going to read that from Amplified. It says, for of course every house is built and furnished by someone. But the builder of all things and the furnisher, now when I say furniture, not furnishing, but how it's furnished, how it's constructed, of the entire equipment of all things is God. God knows each and every one of us. Why? He created us. And he knows that certain things that we need individually that would equip us, or that would furnish us with the tools we need to walk in the fullness of himself. But the challenge is sometimes we try to bring our own furniture there. And because we try to, well, see, God knows my heart. And this is who I am. This is how I do it. Well, see, God is trying to choose who you are, and you become who he is. But we get so dogmatic sometimes in our persistence of think we know what God wants to do rather than hearing what God wants us to do. God said he won't leave us ignorant. Therefore, if you get off the beaten path, it's not God, it's you. It's us. All because we're trying to satisfy the flesh based on what we think are the riches we think we should be going in, rather than one God has chosen for us. They said the steps of the righteous, key word, righteous, are ordered by the Lord. Well, you know, we throw in this thing about righteousness, which we've had teachings on before, and sometimes we don't want to walk in righteousness. We want to walk in right. I keep bringing to the point that righteousness is of the flesh. Righteousness is of the spirit. Which are you? More flesh? More spiritual. The challenge is of knowing not only who you are, but whose you are. But let's just go on so we can just get this cleared up. Verse 5, and Moses was faithful. I'm sorry, Moses barely was faithful in all his house as a servant. Underline that part. As a servant. As a servant. I put down as a note to myself, I say, some believers will not consult with God because they're already knowing what the answer is or what it would be. Are you that type of person? When you really want to hear from God, but you don't go to God because you already know his answer, that means he's already placed something in your spirit, but but you don't want to hear that. You're trying to shake that off because it's not what you want to hear. You're trying to build a wall between the truth and a lie. You're trying to satisfy more of your flesh than God's spirit is trying to direct you. Brothers and sisters, we've all at one time been guilty of that. And you've got to recognize that, because this is why he tells us to God, it's hard. Because as a man think of in his heart or in her heart, so is he or so is she. And what we do in our own little sense, we begin to push away from the truth. Not really understanding it's the truth that's going to make you free. The challenge is some things we don't want to be free of. We have to call it like it. Some things you like what you feel about yourself, and therefore you want to hang around and allow that to linger on, not knowing that it's hindering you from walking in the fullness of God's blessings for and in your life. Recognize that now. Understand that. Unless God builds the house, he who labors labors. But let's read on this right here. It says, and Moses, verse 5, and Moses verily was faithful in all his house as a servant for a testimony of those things which were to be spoken after. But Christ, as a son over his own house, whose house we are, if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope firm unto the end. Now, you know, God has to be allowed to build the house that's inside of you. And I'm talking about the spiritual house here. And I put some notes here. And I'm talking to ministers. Well, who the ministers? All of you. All of us. And the note I placed here was that all ministers spiritually should be faithful as a ministering servant. All ministers should be faithful spiritually as a ministering servant. Now, when I use that term servant, there's another term in the Bible, you look at the Amplified, it says slave. Well, we become a spiritual minister. Become slave to the Word of God. Why? It's under total submission to what the Word says. What to do, how to do, and when to do. That's a slave to the Word. But the challenge is, some of us, we don't want to be slave to the Word because we're too busy trying to be a slave to ourselves. We're trying to, trying to serve two masters. And we know God does not allow that in His Word because He knows the outcome. A lot of the challenges that you might have encountered in your life is because you, in essence, were trying not to be a servant of God, but become more of a servant to yourself. Let's just call it like it is. And because of it, a lot of things that you so desired did not come to pass or have the manifestation that you so desired because of you trying to stick it and do it your way. Many are called, but few are chosen. Because you didn't prove to be faithful and following the direction God has chosen. God has chosen for you and for your life. I had to put a note. Sometimes you have those who want to be a lot more in ministry than just a ministering servant. I'm going to note that. Sometimes you have those who want to be more than just a faithful servant. I know I can do more. I know God has called me to do more because that's who I am. God knows how great anointing is inside of me that I just can't be in this role. I need to step out into another role. Promotions come from the Lord, brothers and sisters. If God didn't call you to be there, I'm not saying that God won't call you to be there one day. But that doesn't mean it's today. I never knew as a little boy, as a young man, when I was being baptized at Jacksonville Coliseum here at that time by Oral Roberts, my brother and I, that he anointed me, that I went under the Spirit, that I was being anointed to become a pastor. I did not know that. I just went under. Yeah. And if I knew that, I probably at that time would have ran from it because I had other things in my mind. But the vision is for an appointed time. and it was not my time to walk in that. It really wasn't my time to understand or recognize it in the fullness that I do now. But yet still, it was done. And the vision God has for me, it was going to prove itself at the appointed time, and it did. It's the same thing with our lives. But we have to be faithful. But we know what we know, that we know what we're supposed to do and when we're supposed to do it. I put a note here, and you turn over to, and turn to Matthew 6:24. You know the scripture, I just brought it up, but I just want you to just look at it in the word itself, okay? Matthew 6:24, get out of the gospel, okay? Read the scripture, you know the scripture, okay? I'm gonna start at verse 23 just to open you up a little bit. It says, but if thine eye be evil, the whole body shall be full of darkness. Evil thought is because you have an evil eye. You see things in your own light, how you want it to be. And sometimes it's evil. It's not godly. We kind of view people who God has chosen to be servants of him as being enemies of him. Hey, Saul and Paul was a perfect example, wasn't it? This man was walking around killing Christians. But come to find out, he was going to be one of the greatest authors of the New Testament that God brought to light. He even stood the ground when the disciples, you know, didn't stand like they were supposed to stand concerning God's word. See, we can't always view things based on what we think or what we see. We have to look through the eyes of God to make sure that we're not moving from a spiritual, divine state into an evil state of mind. People do that. It says here, verse 22, but if thine eye be evil, thy whole body shall be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in thee be darkness, how great is that darkness? Underline that. That's a good question to ask yourself. No man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. You cannot serve God and your flesh. No, you can't. You know, take somebody who tried. You can't do it. It's impossible. It's impossible. You know, in the servitude of God, you have to be submissive, you have to be humble, and you have to be obedient. Submissive, humble, and obedient. Submissive, humble, and obedient. Submissive, humble, and obedient. Let that resonate with you for a while. Because that's a wall. That's what we bring these walls up here in our lives. From here, turn over to John 12 chapter. The book of John 12 chapter. John 12 chapter. 12th chapter of John. I'm going to start back here at verse 25. This part of the problem. He that loveth his life, this John 12th chapter, the book of St. John 12th chapter, beginning the 25th verse, is that he that loveth his life shall lose it. And he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. Now don't get me wrong. When you walk in the Word, you should be the beginning of wisdom and beginning of fruitfulness for your life. You should love that you're in that state. But when you're so caught up of being who you are, this person, this man, this woman, who the world just bows down to in a sense, based on the flesh and not based on the spirit, you got a problem. Some people won't turn to God because they love the life they're living, with the power and the prestige of trying to be better than everybody else. Let me tell you something, and we're going to read this. Once you become a servant of God, that's when your greatness will arise. But that's based on the servitude and not an attitude of gratitude that you think people are supposed to give in you. We use this term empowerment. These some people feel their empowerment, so they become self-serving. They feel that, oh, you need to bow to me because of who I am, the title I hold. What title is that? What title is that? If you're serving God, you're serving God. And because of it, you're humble, you're submissive, and most of all, you're obedient. But the challenge is, we begin to harden our hearts to these concepts. We begin to harden our heart to those beliefs. Therefore, our blessings, the promises for our life, they begin to become delayed. They become to be torn apart, and in some cases, get totally eradicated based on our disobedience and the hardening of our heart concerning God's word. Let's read on this right here. It says here, verse 26, if any man serve me, let him follow me, and where I am, there he'll also my servant. It says, my servant be. Those who serve him be. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor. That's where your honor comes from being a servant, a humble, submissive, obedient servant to God. God will honor you. That's when you begin to find yourself being lifted up before the eyes of men. Because they'll recognize then, really, who you are and whose you are. Hear me well, brothers and sisters. Promotion comes from the Lord, not from you. You know, it comes from the Lord. One of the things that, as I looked at this, we have to realize that everything has a season. And that season is based on how in a state of total submissiveness you are. Turn to Matthew 23. Matthew chapter 23. I'm going to bring you to the Bible. You need to open your Bible more anyway, so that's good. 23rd chapter of Matthew. Oh, I love it, because it's probably been a long time since you've been running through this Bible like I'm doing for you right now. Thank the Lord. Thank you, Lord. Matthew 23. 23rd chapter of Matthew. Look at verse 11. You can go to verse 10, but we'll come down to verse 11. It said, neither be you called masters, for one is your master, even Christ. Verse 11, but he that is greatest among you shall be your servant. That's going to determine your greatness. The more servitude you display, the more servitude that you have, the more of your attitude of becoming a servitude will lift you up. That's where your greatness will be shown and displayed, not by you, but by God. Read that again. But he that is greatest among you shall be your servant. Humility is something else. He gave a base to the proud, but he lifted up that person who's willing to be a servant no matter what comes their way. Pride comes before fall. Even in today's society, we've seen many people who we thought were great, how they're falling. In the latter days, in the early days, flat on their face, all because they sought after that greatness to be honored by men rather than be honored and raised up by God. Are you in that category? Do you get frustrated because people don't recognize you being this such spiritual person, that this anointing you have on you? Let me tell you something. The gifts are calling of God without repentance. But yet and still, your gift will be recognized. Why? Because God will elevate it in all of which you don't have to promote it. God will let them recognize it. And they will begin to bow not to you, but to that spirit and that special anointing that's inside of you, brothers and sisters. Don't harden yourself to that. You know, as I looked at that verse there, it just brought me to what we're going to right now. Turn back to Hebrews. Turn back to Hebrews. Get down to verse 6 again. But Christ, as a son over his own house, Hebrews 3:6, but Christ, as a son over his own house, whose house are we, if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope firm unto the end. You got to stand on it. Don't worry about what others are doing or what they're not doing. You stand on what God is calling you to do. The vision is for the appointed time. It says here, verse 7, wherefore, as the Holy Ghost say, today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your heart as in the provocation. That's what they did, and they went off into the wilderness, the children of Israel. They prayed for God. They wanted God to deliver them. They wanted God to take them out of Egypt, and as soon as they got some free, they said, okay, now I'm my own man. Forget it about who brought them out of that bondage, who freed them from the bondage that Pharaoh had placed upon them, who was taking them to the land of milk and honey. But yet, it's still in that point, God recognized they began to harden their heart. They didn't want to hear God's word anymore. They felt that they freed themselves, and yet still they were going to be free in totality and walk as individuals, forgetting who their Savior really was, or who he really is. And I use that term. Yeah. Sometimes we forget who Jesus was and who he really is in our life today. If you start out in faith, don't end up in your flesh, don't end up in foolishness. That's when the hardening of your heart begins. Brother and sister, Paul at one time was guilty of this right here. You know, if God says to you right now, just send Pastor Locker some love messages. And I just use it as you all do it anyway, so I'm not worried about that. But just say if he said it, and said it, but you were and angry with Pastor Locker. And Pastor Locker, he's not doing this, he's not doing that. God said, send him some love and that you're thankful and grateful. Well, you don't want to hear that. You don't want to do that. And you were getting the heart, I'm not sending him nothing. I know y'all don't do that, but I'm just saying that, you know, that spirit can rise up. I'm not doing a thing. Or to one of your relatives or one of your loved ones. See, that's where the hardening of your heart comes to play. That's when you begin to do the opposite of what God's word is telling you to do. That's when you begin to go into a state of despair. And it's irreparable because then it begins to irritate God. Let me finish reading this right here. Oh, yes, I was never untold. Wherefore, the Holy Ghost said today, if you will hear his voice, and my sheep know my voice now, harden not your hearts as in the day, in the provocation, in the day of temptation, in the wilderness. When your fathers tempted me, proved me, and saw my works 40 years, wherefore I was grieved with that generation, and said, they do always err in their hearts, and they have not known my ways. Well, in order to know somebody's ways, you got to spend time with them. And because people don't spend enough time with God, they begin to hear their own voice or hear what they want to hear. Remember we did the teaching on itching ears. They have these ears trying to follow people who are saying what they say and thinking what they think, which is maybe totally opposite of what God wants you to hear and the ways God wants you to follow. David was called a man after God's own heart. All because he not only understood God's word, he knew and understood God's ways. And that came from spending time with God, spending time in his word. Brothers and sisters, you hear this term, self-made men and self-made women. That's a lie. Don't lie to yourself. God made men, God made women. But when you become self-made, this means that you now are directing your life the way you think it should be, rather than the direction God wants you to be in. Why? Because your heart has been totally hardened to the principles, to the views, and to the word that God has placed inside of you. Or did you hear it? You turn a deaf ear
to God's word.
And that's a challenge. That's a challenge. It says here, when your father tempted me and proved me and saw my works 40 years. In other words, even in that period of time when God was taking him through the wilderness, and you know, we read the stories about how they wanted food and God gave them food. They wanted meat and God gave them meat. They wanted water, God gave them water. Yet it's still, they still hardened their heart that he wasn't doing enough. He brought them all out here. Oh, in Egypt we had this, we had that. He brought us out here, this wilderness right here to be struggling and so forth. The Bible said not one of their shoe soles worn out, not any of their garments they were wearing wore out. That God had protected them the whole time, and yet it's still, they rebelled because of the hardening of their heart. Brothers and sisters, how many God, let's get down. How many times God told you in your house to forgive your children or your loved ones, your boo? He said, forgive them. No. You're hardening your heart. You're hardening your heart. As in your Deborah, you're hardening your heart, and the results will be totally different than what you think. The challenge is how submissive, how humble, how submissive and how obedient are you becoming? And I just ran out of time. Just ran out of time. I tell you, we can finish this up next week. But the challenge is, how hard is your heart towards God's word, his voice in your life? We're going to finish this up because we want to see the repercussions of allowing your heart to be hardened. The results are not good. This is why he tells us to guard this heart. My sheep know my voice. That right there is a sign. Are you a sheep or are you a goat? A donkey. My sheep know my voice. And a stranger they won't follow. The last time I read, the only thing that have, that sheep or humility have are shepherds over them. And the Bible said, if the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Where are you today?
Oh,
are your wants still there?
My God.
Is your need still there?
When I in awesome.
It's important for us to understand who we are.
Consider
and what we are. We serve a great God.
The
we serve a great, loving, giving God.
Have made.
Why can't we trust him? Why can't we submit to him?
I see the stars.
As you think about this,
I hear
allow
the
your spirit to resonate with his.
Thunder.
Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, we come before you right now. We're taking inventory of ourselves right now. We're taking inventory of not only who we are, but also who we're supposed to be in you. Help us to realize, Father God, that you hold back no good thing for us. We have to understand and recognize, Father God, that you came, that Jesus came to give us life and give it to us more abundantly.
And
that, Father God, it's your good will, it's in your good will that we prosper and be in good health, even of our spirit, our soul prospers, Father. Help us to realize, Father God, that we can't do nothing on our own, but only through your word, Father. That's where our victory lies, Father. And through your
word.
Help us, Father God, to submit ourselves to what the word is really saying. Not to what we want it to say, but what it's really saying in and for our lives. Father God, I thank you today. I thank you today knowing, Father God, that your word will not return back to you void. That it will accomplish what you sent it out to do in each and every one of our lives. Oh, Father God, I thank you for your patience. I thank you for your love. I thank you for your grace. Because disobedient children, we all walked in at one time. Even some now are pushing back rather than moving forward, God. Rather than pressing on towards the high calling that you have for them, Father, here on the earth. Oh, Father God.
How great
continue to allow your greatness to help us fulfill the dream that you have for each and every one of us, Father, here on earth. Help us to realize, Father God, through following you, it's our pathway to one day being with you, Father. Help us to realize, Father God, that we can do all things through your word, through Christ, who strengthened us, Father. Lord, I thank you today. I praise you today for each and every person under the sound of this voice, that they're not hearing you, but they're hearing you. They're listening to you for your direction for their lives, Father God. That they're not allowing themselves to hard to be hard, Father, and push it away, but loosen up to move forward, Father. Your word told us last week that the pure heart shall see God. We want to see you, Father. We want to be with you, Father. We want to recognize you, Father. We want to walk with you, Father. Lord, I thank you today. I praise you today for this word, your word, coming forth with power and might, and acknowledging, Father God, that it's a blessing. It is truly a blessing for me as well as for others. And I thank you for it, Father. I thank you for it all. In your most precious name, Jesus' name, let the church say, amen.